This is chapter one of the Hildr Chronicles. It is called A Thousand Leaves. Kjuku lived in a small fishing village on the western side of Esu Island that would one day be known as Hokkaido. The Ainu people called it Otarunai, the sandy beach. In the year 998 AD, Kyoko was getting ready for a summer festival that traditionally welcomed the spirits of the dead to join them for one joyful evening. Dancing through the streets, dressed up as heinous beasts or devilish ghouls, was meant to bring back good luck to the fishermen and sanctify the harvests to come. As Kyoko shut the bamboo wicket door to her old hut, she almost caught herself saying goodbye. She felt a cold jolt in her chest and shivered as if a ghost was slipping through her body. Robajan had passed away a few weeks before. Her grandmother had been the only family member left, and she very well knew now that she was living scandalously on her own. She was vulnerable. At best, somebody might force her to become their wife. Some brute could pinch the family rice fields, or even send her off to the town brothel, and she wouldn't be able to do a thing about it. As if it wasn't hard enough to have lost the only person left in her small world who cared about her. Well, that was not entirely true. Kyoko held on to that thought and unwaveringly walked away, towing a small cart with a few belongings. Otarunai was not a large town, but it was relatively far away from the rice farm homes below the lush green hills and the quiet volcanoes. It was going to be a long and warm evening stroll on a muddy, uneven track riddled with holes and fallen branches from recent storms. The weird ambulance sound of cicada choirs kept her company while she played out in her mind how the evening would go, just as she had done for the last few weeks. When Kyoko arrived with her mukuri, it's an instrument you put in your mouth and pull on an elastic band to make sounds. With the mukuri instrument hidden beneath her yukata, the fate was already in full swing. Groups of villagers hopped and twirled with their kaku tambourines and tonkori stringed instruments. They swayed and skipped along as they pretended that imaginary ghosts blended in with the inebriated. Kyoko's heart pounded louder than the percussions when she noticed the boy in Oni costume leading the procession. Takeshi was the son of the wealthiest family in Otarunai that owned most rice fields, fishing boats, and even a small sake brewery. His ugly red ogre mask was an intended reminder of how diametrically opposite his fine features were underneath, and few female onlookers had forgotten. As he walked by, Kyoko tried tried to smile to him as she plucked a string, a touch between a bamboo reed and her teeth. Takeshi ignored her. He must have been either too busy leading the phantasmagorical parade or too drunk to notice her disappointed face drown in the waves of sweaty admirers. Kyoko stuffed her childish instrument into an inside pocket of her colorful rainbow yukata. She had spent all year making it with the help of her grandmother. She completed the last finishing touches only hours before setting off to town along the tiresome lane. As she looked over her shoulder, holding back her tears, Kyoko was sure she could see the dead creeping around the merry men and women. Some were perched on rooftops, mischievously flicking pine cones and rhino beetles over the edge. Others with scary horns lurked behind trees, as if selecting a victim to possess. She also thought she could see translucent corpses floating over the crowd, sniffing at shiny perspiring scalps or groping generous breasts. Was her grandmother amongst them? A shiver ran down her spine and she hurried away towards the beach where Takeshi said he would meet her on this special day. Such a pretty flower in the dirt, croaked a woman behind the beverage stall. Kyoko knew straight away who the putrid voice belonged to. Too late for the parade, are we? Oh, your son played his part magnificently, Orisama. Kyoko replied, staring down at her worn-out geta shoes. When she flicked up her eyes to meet Mrs. Oru's disgruntled stare, Kyoko saw a fat, hairy moth climbing over the woman's shoulder. It was the biggest moth she had ever seen. In fact, an acrontilachysis. The strange skull symbol on its thorax made her skin crawl. Mrs. Oru seemed to notice what the girl was staring at and casually knocked the black insect to the floor with the back of her hand. It emitted a faint shriek as she crushed it under her red geta's teeth. I'm sure he did. We expect only the best from our Takeshi, as I'm sure you understand, said Takeshi Oru's mother ominously, serving Kyoko a cup of overflowing sake that the young woman rejected, politely with a praying gesture. Please, I insist, heard Mrs. Oru, heavily perspiring. It's going to be a cold night. Throat back home to your little hut is long, isn't it? I think you'll be needing some, considering your current predicament. All alone in the hills. The road ahead is indeed a long and bleak one, is it not? Kyoko tried to show no offense and gave a respectful nod, accepting the drink. She took a little sip, forcing her facial muscles to avoid showing how unpleasant this family brew really was. But Mrs. Oru gave her a sour look that that Kyoko understood as drink up. When Oru's wrinkled expression softened to a thin-lipped smirk, Kyoko left the self-entitled woman behind to bicker with her husband groveling behind the stall. The pine trees near the sandy shore were battered by the coastal winds. Kyoko leaned against the scaly brown rice bark of a large pine tree growing in the dunes. She coughed a while and spat a few drops of foul alcohol still in her mouth. The torches around the village were beginning to twist like foxtails and blur out of focus. She fell to her knees and felt the cool sea breeze stroke her skin. Why didn't Takeshi bother return a smile? Takeshi Oru, where are you? The sea was as dark as Kyoko's long, oily hair, calm as a graveyard. Her geta teeth dug into the warm sand as she plodded forwards to see the bright moon more clearly. That's when she heard Takeshi call her name. The young man had removed his wooden demon mask. The gentle breeze billowed his light black kimono as Takeshi grew closer, reaching out to touch Kyoko's bony shoulders.
Dear Kyoko-chan, I'm glad you came.
Kyoko didn't dare look up at him, and Takeshi lifted her chin with his left index finger.
There's something I have to tell you.
Kyoko's squid-ink eyebrows tilted slightly inward, exposing a few worry lines on her forehead. So have I, Takeshi-kun. I've been waiting so long for this day to arrive.
We had a special moment after your grandmother's funeral, I have to admit. There was even a time when I let my guard down and believed we could be together.
An uncanny hissing breeze played with a lock of Kyoko's hair. Then a pale woman with fox features whispered something into Kyoko's ear.
You will claim your milk and body bewitched him.
Kyoko's blood froze.
I think you know what you are doing, imposing your soft skin on such an innocent boy,
implied Takeshi.
You thought you could trap me into marriage? How could I present a tainted woman to my parents?
You see, here's the kitsune before vanishing. Kyoko's watery eyes opened and understood what was about to happen. She knew he was out of her league, that her ancestry and livelihood were not a suitable match for such a family as his. But the kiss they had shared by the broken bridge had raised all questions of suitability and respectable betrothal. You said we could run away together, she blurted out. I was ready. My belongings are hidden in the bamboo woods. Takeshi looked away to gaze at the waves crashing on the rocks out at sea. Wind was building up, and a sudden chill made him step backwards, letting go of Kyoko.
I'm sorry, Kyoko. It was pleasant being with you, But there's more to life than dreaming. I must honor my obligations. I will not be tricked into doing what I do not want to do. I'm sure you understand.
You said you loved me. Kyoko whimpered, grabbing an arm.
That's what they say to get between your thighs.
Snickered a ghastly corpse slithering around Takeshi's body. Kyoko shrieked, and lightning struck out at sea. Takeshi was not easily startled and put an end to his dumping ritual.
Hayate-sa, I don't think I ever loved you. I must have been feeling sorry for you, that's all. Find someone else to bother. Now, let go of my arm and work your charms on someone else. There are places for girls like you.
Kyoko couldn't breathe. Takeshi's last words were muffled by the sibilant gusts of wind lashing their bodies. Screams trumpeted out from the village beyond the woodland dunes. A thousand leaves swarmed the sky. Wild flames uncoiled from demolished houses and snapped at the stars. Kyoko winced as she saw her Takeshi being skinned alive with razor-sharp winds tearing rocks and trees from the ground, hurling homes into the distance. Takeshi was paralyzed in shock. His lidless eyes watched Kyoko fade into the cutting whirlwinds of sand, mincing his flesh and splintering his bones. The village was ripped apart, fishing boats smashed into fox shrines. Wooden planks, bricks, and shiny tiles beheaded villagers, chopped their heads off, disemboweled their livestock. The whole rampus generated much excitement amongst the aroused, ghostly bystanders, ripping their own heads off and howling to the red moon. Takeshi's blood sprayed like shattered rubies into the icy waves, and a humongous tornado smacked the sand with a violence that it sounded like a volcano erupting. Otarunai was gone. The sacred Oru family was no more. Everyone Kyoko once knew had been silenced. While a wooden cart filled with Kyoko's meager belongings floated down a muddy stream, the Phantom Parade continued to thrive into the dead of night. See you next time.
Arthur.